This is CBS Eye on the World. I'm John Batchelor, and it's a pleasure to speak to Colonel Jeff McCausland, United States Army retired, the author, Jeff McCausland, of the book Battle Tested, Gettysburg Leadership Lessons for 21st Century Leaders. It is July 1st, 1863. John Reynolds commands Three Corps, the left wing of the Union Army. He identifies that Gettysburg up ahead of him is likely to be a major battle. He pushes in with his advance marching corps. There's one particular unit that we now call the Iron Brigade. It's made up of men from the Midwest, in particular Wisconsin. That's what he has to throw into a battle where Buford's men are reeling back. Now, Jeff, this is a tough one because John Reynolds is much admired. You know Gettysburg Battlefield very well. There's a statue to where he fell. And yet, why was he so far up front, the commander of Three Corps?
That's a great question. In fact, he was not only the commander of Three Corps, John. He had been given, we call in the military, operational command of that entire left wing of those Three Corps. So in total, for operational purposes, he was in command of 25,000 Union soldiers. They arrive on Gettysburg. As you said, they go to McPherson's Ridge with the Iron Brigade. Reynolds has been decisively engaged, and they're now moving the cavalry out to the flanks, and the Iron Brigade and the infantry are now taking over the centerpiece of the battle. Reynolds moves well forward and begins to position individual regiments, and he gets to a certain area where the Iron Brigade is, and there is about 840 men from a regiment from Wisconsin. Reynolds actually rides up, only guy now on horseback in that area amongst the Union soldiers, and he says, "Forward, men, forward, for God's sake, drive those people from the trees right there." As he gives that particular order, bam, a musket ball hits John Reynolds in the back of the head, and he is dead before he literally hits the ground. And this is a good teaching point for leaders, because in any crisis, even the 21st century, I always say to leaders, still in all, despite our technology, where you are physically is an incredibly important decision for you to make. And when you think about John Reynolds, you certainly admire him for his courage. He was a highly admired officer. He'd been offered command of the Army of the Potomac by Lincoln, and for a host of reasons had turned that down. But that particular day, even though he was commanding 25,000, when he's killed in battle, he's actually commanding 840. So the question then is, why would he do that? Why shouldn't he have been farther back orchestrating the maneuver of that larger force, whereas when he goes forward, he's actually only commanding a handful? And you can argue this a whole bunch of ways as a teaching point. One could argue, on the one hand, being far forward, it was a critical moment for the organization, an existential moment, and therefore the leader being present was invaluable, even though he was killed in the fight. Or you can argue somewhat that John Reynolds was, in fact, even though a great man, a great leader, and very courageous, he was micromanaging his organization, because there was a colonel in the command of that regiment, and Reynolds could have simply given him orders and allowed him to deploy his forces. Either way, it's an interesting teaching point even for 21st century leaders, but sadly for the Union Army, John Reynolds is dead after only a few hours on the battlefield.
Robert E. Lee, the extremely dominating leader of the Confederate Army, has in his mind something that is not obvious when you first read this story. And you make a point of it, Jeff, because some of the decisions that Lee forces on his men are on the basis of his assumption that there is not time to win this war if we're matching battle for battle. We've got to win decisively. Do I say correctly that Lee has in his mind he must destroy the Union Army? Because if he continues to bleed the Union Army, as his army bleeds, he will lose. Does he think that when he arrives on the battlefield?
Well, I certainly think that is true, John. I mean, I tell people when Robert E. Lee comes north in the spring and summer of 1863, he's not coming north to win a battle. He's coming north to win the war. For the reasons you say, he suggests, you know, we're winning battles, but we're losing the war because we just don't have the men and materiel that the Union can put on the field. And at the same time, of course, even though the war is going fairly well for the Confederacy in the East, Lee has just had the stunning victories at Fredericksburg in December of 1862, nearly destroys the Union Army at Chancellorsville in May of 1863. The war is going poorly for the South, particularly in the West, And as this battle unfolds, of course, the last Confederate stronghold on the Mississippi River is under siege by Ulysses S. Grant, that being Vicksburg. And when that falls, of course, the Union then will have full control of the Mississippi River and basically divide the Confederacy in half. So following those two victories at Fredericksburg and Chancellorsville, I think Lee really believes this is the moment that we can push it over the edge. If I can just defeat the Yankees again, particularly on Northern Territory, and then perhaps threaten the major city. Their goal initially was Harrisburg as a state capital of a very important state, but perhaps then to Philadelphia or Baltimore or perhaps even Washington. If I can do that, I can tip this war. If not militarily, I can tip this war politically, knowing full well that Abraham Lincoln is going to face the voters in the fall of 1864. Perhaps the Union would then elect a president more amenable to negotiating a settlement that would allow the Confederacy to become independent. So I really believe it's Lee's goal to win the war by a decisive victory at Gettysburg.
And yet, Richard Ewell leading the corps from the north, Jackson's corps, Richard Ewell is the youngest of the corps commanders, Longstreet and Hill, and he has an opportunity that first day to overwhelm the Reynolds' three corps, overwhelm and win the battle. However, Lee sends him what you call a discretionary order. Does that suggest that Lee was not thinking he was going to win the battle or was being cautious? I puzzle about this, Jeff.
No, I don't think it was, frankly, John, I don't think it was either of those things. I think it was just a matter of Robert E. Lee's leadership style. And each one of us has a leadership style that we're comfortable with for those who work for us. And that style will operate on an extreme from absolute total control to absolute total empowerment. And we all operate somewhere on that particular continuum. Lee liked to empower his subordinates, liked to give them broad guidance and allow them to operate, and had found over the last 16 months that he'd been in command that that had afforded him many opportunities for success. But I think what he fails to realize is that the people he's commanding have now changed significantly in a real big way, and that is, of course, for the Confederates, the loss of Thomas Stonewall Jackson, who was shot by his own men and killed at Chancellorsville, is a big hole. And Lee has decided in the few weeks prior to coming north that he's going to reorganize the Confederate Army and move it from having just two corps to having three corps. He has to elevate a lower-ranking officer, in this case Ewell, to take over of command of the corps that Jackson was in command with, and Ewell had been one of Jackson's subordinates, and then also make A.P. Hill the commander of a newly formed corps, because the Confederate Army will be about the largest it's going to be throughout the war, about 75,000 or so troops. So that's that leadership style that Lee had enjoyed and found worked for him doesn't work quite so well when I give that guidance of discretion to Ewell, who was not used to that, had only been a corps commander for a couple of weeks now, as opposed to Jackson. And there's been many conjectures, even been books written about, well, what would have happened if Stonewall Jackson had been present. I can tell you, in my humble opinion, if Jackson had been there and had gotten that discretionary order, he would have continued the attack. That was his style, very aggressive. So I think Lee is really following his instincts and his style. And really, in many ways, though people hold Ewell at fault for not progressing aggressively, I really fault Lee, really, because I think he should have realized the new person he had in command and adjusted his style accordingly and been more direct if that's what he wanted him to do.
The book is battle-tested, Gettysburg Leadership Lessons for 21st Century Leaders. Jeff McCausland is the author. It's the end of the first day. The Union forces are arriving through the night. The Confederate forces have arrived and are in position for the second day of the Battle of Gettysburg. Lee is going to have a very important conversation with his corps commander, his veteran corps commander, James Longstreet, when we come back. This is CBS Eye on the World. I'm speaking to Colonel Jeff McCausland, United States Army, retired. I'm John Batchelor.
You're listening to CBS Eye on the World with John Batchelor.